And also, this is the last talk of the conference, and I have this special honor to, I think, express the gratitude of all participants to the organizers of this conference. And there are six organizers. I think this is Kuhn, Professor Kwak, Konda, Ogiza, Lee, and who else I missed, I think, yeah.
Kono.
And Kono, right, yeah. All right, so yeah, thank you very much. Yeah. So I gave this similar talk already in Kyoto last week, and so I think there was only one attendant of my talk, Professor Schroeder. So but I hope nobody else attended my talk. So yes, I usually don't like to recycle my talks, but this time I think there are too many conferences, kind of difficult not to recycle talks, I think. Yes, okay, so let me just remind, I think just probably many of you know this is by now, it's very familiar thing, just and maybe even could be called classical Mackay correspondence. So you start with a finite subgroup of SU2, or if SL2 over C, if you want, which acts on the naturally on C2, and you consider this orbit space. And minimally resolve it. So this will be projection P to the orbit space, and this will be minimal resolution. So this has a distinguished point, the orbit of the origin, and this is a singular point of this surface, and of course, we know this due to dual, which is like something like around the 30s, remarkable observation that if you take the fiber of this resolution, this is an exceptional curve, which will be union of a curves. Each curve is a isomorphic to P1, and its self-intersection on this non-singular surface is equal to minus 2. And they form the diagram, so just the intersection graph. It's a Dimkin diagram. Now, of type which is given by kind of table. So in fact, this is for experts, of course, this is a double rational point. And all double rational point analytically isomorphic to this kind of situation. And this kind of gives you kind of table. So if this is a group, say gamma, and the type of Dimkin diagram. So if this is, say, cyclic group of order Cn plus 1, the type will be A1. And of course, we know classification of all subgroups of finite subgroup for SU2. This is finite. So they correspond to binary polyhedral groups. And so this is, will be the, if this is binary dihedral group, then this will be, I think, Dn minus 2. If it's binary tetrahedron group, this will be 6. If it's binary octahedron group, it will be 7. And if it's binary icosahedron group, this will be E8. So what Mackay observed, so we consider the representation, linear representation of your group gamma in vector space V, and let's consider all irreducible representation, or better, isomorphic classes. In fact, let's delete from the set trivial representation, trivial one-dimensional representation. And so, okay, observe that this set in one-to-one corresponds to this set of this curves. So if, like, after reordering, I may assume that, say, rho r, rho I, say, just let's this set is equal to rho 1, say, rho, say, s. And I can match irreducible representation with this curve. And, of course, this is not just a kind of bijection of sets, but it's really a very remarkable bijection. So just in this bijection, these two components intersect. If and only one, if only if you take this representation rho I, you tensor with the natural two-dimensional representation, like gamma sits in SU2, and of course it's x linearly on C2. So this is what I call natural representation of my group gamma. If I tensor this II with this two-dimensional representation, then it has rho j as a Dirac sum. So in other words, the multiplicity of this irreducible representation in the tensor product is non-zero, is greater than equal to 1. So there are other things which you can remarkably suggest. For example, dimension of this representation is the coefficients of the multiple of the maximal root as kind of vector corresponding to E. So remember, all these Dynkin diagrams come with certain exponents, for example, like this is what we know from theory of elliptic surfaces. For example, this is my diagram 8, and if you add one more fiber, one more vertex, this is a Kodaira fiber of type 2 star, and there is a multiplicity attached, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 3, 4, 2. And this is the numbers, so interpreted if you assign to each vertex a simple root in the corresponding root system, this is the coefficient of the maximal root. So the representation which corresponds, say, to this vertex must be six-dimensional. Representation corresponding to this vertex is two-dimensional. And this is kind of reserved for the trivial representation, really. So it's like one-dimensional trivial representation. Because this comes in Kodaira fiber with multiplicity one. So this is just referred to be a kind of Mackay correspondence. For finite subgroup of SU2. So this was the first explanation was given by kind of geometric explanation of this thing was given by Gonzalez Springberger. This is one person. And Les Verdier, this joint paper. And independently by Knorr. So in the late 70s, they gave really nice explanation for this. So what we do, so let, say, E rho, or maybe E is not very good notation. So will be a trivial vector bundle on C2. So this is my representation, so just corresponding to V rho. So it's representing some vector space V, so just which corresponds to rho. So this kind of vector space. And I consider it as a trivial bundle of C2, but not trivial as a G bundle. Consider it as a gamma bundle. So this means it has a natural linearization. So just my group acts on the base on C2, and of course it acts on my vector space via my representation. So this trivial bundle admits natural linearization with respect to the section. Or in other words, it's called gamma bundle. Okay, so as a gamma bundle, of course, it's very non-trivial bundle. But as a bundle, if you forget about action, of course, it's just trivial because there are no non-trivial bundle over C2. Okay? So what we can do, so let's push it down here. What I do, I take P lower star, And but take P log star kind of gamma invariant. Okay. So consider this now as a coherent sheaf or just locally free sheaf. I identify bundles with locally free sheaves. Then, of course, I have the operation. I can push it down to the orbit space and take subsheaf of gamma invariant sections, right? So this is kind of usual notation for this functor. This kind of gamma invariant push down, right? So this is just push down and take gamma invariant sections. Okay, this will get you a coherent sheaf. This is map is not flat. It's not bundle anymore. It's a coherent sheaf on the orbit space. What can I do? I pull it back to my resolution. And now I got myself a coherent sheaf on the resolution. But unfortunately, in fact, it always have, it has torsion, kill torsion, kill distortion. So when you can get to this resolution, you may have coherent sheaf with a torsion, kill it. And you get yourself kind of sheaf, which I call like F rho. And the claim in this theorem, F rho is a vector bundle. So this means locally free. And if you take first Chern class of this, which belongs to second cohomology group, this is a non-compact, but still it's, everything is defined. This is a surface, non-singular surface. So I can define C1 and evaluate. So call it, say, OI, I think, yeah. And evaluate on jth component. Take the value of this H2 on the fundamental class of component. You get, if you match this like this, this will be Kronecker symbol. So it's equal to, yeah, you know what's Kronecker symbol, right? So this is just, in fact, you can really even more, what you do, just you can take this vector bundle and you can say it differently and restrict to EJ. This will be just P1. And so, and this will be just trivial bundle of the rank is equal to dimension of my representation. If I not equal to j. And otherwise, it will be, I think, just it has one component, OP1, 1, plus OP1, dimension, or minus 1, if I is equal to j. It's similar. It's equivalent. Okay. So decompose, see, this becomes trivial if component is different. It's not attached to your representation. But on a component which attached to a representation, this bundle splits non-trivially.
Sorry. Is necessary such that there is a correspondence between the representation and the EI?
What?
I mean, this correspondence, representation, rho I to EI.
Yeah.
This has to prove there is.
This was observed by Mackay. Oh. No, this is observation of Mackay. This is just because, look, this is a very simple group, one of the simplest possible groups. There's a character tables. And just, in fact, Mackay introduced a so-called Mackay graph for any group. And so just he kind of checked it for this kind of special case, this graph coincides with the Dynkin diagram, right? Well, this is just observation, and this kind of geometric explanation of that. Okay, so this is, of course, just a theorem, okay, this observation, but I think this is kind of tells you, gives you really the explanation. So this is just explanation, but from this kind of arose this kind of was kind of not that kind of important because after all this is just the fact about some really simple groups, simple in the sense they're easier to understand. This is what we learn in every I think group theory course. This kind of first examples of groups are subgroups of SU2, but of course this kind of gave rise to the whole industry now. I think just the Mackay correspondence is now really very fashionable thing, just and can be generalized in very different ways. So the first generalization came from work of Kapranov, Vassero, but now the state of the art is the following theorem. So first observation, first note that there's a way to get this resolution in a very nice way. This belongs to Nakamura. I forgot his first initial.
I,
yeah. So this resolution of this double rational point can be is equal to what by definition is equal to C2, not mod G, but double slash gamma. And this means the closure of regular orbits of gamma in C2 in the Hilbert scheme so this is, stands for the Hilbert scheme of zero-dimensional subschemes of C2 of length is equal to the cardinality of my group. And regular orbit means the orbit with trivial stabilizer. Okay, so consider all orbits with trivial stabilizers, they must be of this cardinality. Consider them as a reduced subscheme of C2 and then close it in the whole Hilbert scheme. And this will be reducible variety and this is isomorphic to resolution. So from now on, it always, of course, you can define it now for in any situation. You have a finite group acting on any variety, so if gamma, any group gamma, acts on X, I can always define, and this is kind of called now Hilbert quotient of my, so it's not a kind of orbit space, this is definition. So there will be closure of the regular orbits in the Hilbert scheme of X or the appropriate cardinality. So this is kind of generalized to any variety. So now the state of the art is now theorem of Bridgeland, King, and Reed is the following. So suppose gamma, again, gamma, any group, any finite group, not necessarily this group, acts on X equipped, this is manifold, not single manifold, equipped with holomorphic symplectic structure.
You're not
finite? Yeah, always finite, yeah. Holomorphic symplectic structure. So we already had a talk about this. And preserve it. And the action preserves the structure. So it means there is a holomorphic symplectic form in X. This is manifold. And my action just leaves this fixed. Okay, so it's invariant. Okay. So suppose this Hilbert quotient, of course, it always has a natural projection to orbit space. It comes from this definition. It's a Krepent resolution. Krepent resolution. I think we all know what it is, right? Yeah. Okay, the preimage of canonical class, this is kind of quotient singularity. Preimage of canonical class will be just is equal to canonical class. Yeah. Is a Krepent resolution. Then we have this diagram again. X goes to X gamma orbit space, and this is resolution. So this is not always true. It's not necessarily Krepent resolution, but it's always true if dimension of X at most 3. So I will apply to this case of dimension 2, so it's always true, okay? But this was very non-trivial result, it's also true in dimension 3. So then we have the same similar thing, we have this projection to the orbit space, and we have now minimal resolution, which really, maybe just I put this diagram here. So what you have here, because this is now part of the Hilbert scheme, and we all know that over Hilbert scheme there is a universal family. So it comes from a universal family, so just which parameterize this zero-dimensional cycles. And I can restrict this universal family to this closure of this regular orbit, so just I have this, I can complete this diagram to this. And this will be now universal family. This is my projection pi, P, this is pi, and then say K put here P bar, and this will be P bar. Okay? So now I have this kind of diagram, which kind of makes this kind of commutative thing. So now what I can do, so I can define the functor now from, okay, so derive categories of, you take the cogerent sheaf on X, but they all will be gamma invariant. So gamma sheafs. Again, you can say what does it mean. So it's kind of cogerent sheaf on X, which admits action of gamma, which lifts the action of gamma on X. So this is kind of well-defined category of cogerent sheaf. And then I take bounded derived category of cogerent sheaf on my resolution. And there is a natural transformation, which nowadays is called the Fourier-Mukai transform. What you can do, you start with my cogerent sheaf here. So what you do is you take, pull it back. In fact, this is not cogerent sheaf, this is complex. Kind of represent this element by complex of cogerent sheaf. You pull it back on Z, and then take derived image of P. And again, on this projection, my group will act. In fact, the fibers will be orbits. But the fibers of the universal orbits will be just orbits of my group gamma, not necessarily regular orbits. Okay, over exceptional divisors will be really non-regular orbits. So you take this kind of functor, and this is just so, so just then this will be, so this is my functor, F, phi. So you take the complex, pull it back, and then push it down by taking like gamma invariant complex, I think. And this is well-defined functor. And somehow what you do, it's kind of remarkable thing. You kind of get the reading of the action. So you kind of, this is in fact, all this kind of came from physics, because they just this kind of, all these kind of things which people call stringy things in physics, yeah. So you have kind of space on which the group acts, and you consider some object which is really gamma invariant, right? Now you found another space on which this kind of object corresponds to another space, and you forgot about action, okay? Because now this is just honest cogerent sheaf on this non-singular variety, and before this, you kind of think about this kind of G gamma object on X as some kind of cogerent sheaf on the orbit space, which is not very well defined because it has singularity. For example, vector bundle, it's kind of tricky to say what is it. So just by considering this kind of orbit space object on the orbit space, you consider it as a really gamma object on X, and then but then you assign the honest object on the resolution of singularities somehow. In fact, just you can say everything in terms of stacks, because some kind of you take, instead of there's just orbit space, you can take like what we know the stack, and then by definition, the cogerent sheaves on the stack are just exactly this category. So the category of cogerent sheaf on this stack, the quotient stack, this is definition, okay? So just in some sense, what you were able to do, just category of, on this kind of difficult object like stack, is transformed to the category of kind of usual familiar object on some kind of natural object associated to this quotient, which is a resolution of singularities, okay? So this is just the, this is just...
No map from the resolution to stack, only to the cores.
No, there is, yeah, but I think this kind of geometric, yeah, this is kind of the, what is called, coarse modulus space of the stack, right, yeah, right. There's no map to the stack, right, okay? So this is the state of the art in Mukai correspondence. This is kind of the best so far result in this industry, right? And I think so. This is kind of always kind of this is a kind of slogan. So the category, like in simple words, the slogan now, the G object on the space is an object on the Krepent resolution. But unfortunately, very often there's no Krepent resolution. Of course, what has it to do to this subgroup of SU2? Because in this kind of example, of course, you might take X. In fact, you can take X any for even dimensional space to n.
But what's the conclusion of
this theorem? Oh, it's a conclusion of category, sorry. Okay. Thank you. Yeah, I got distracted, yeah? Okay. Equivalence of category. Thank you very much. So this functor is the equivalence of category. Right, sorry. Yeah, okay. So, of course, just what has to do with the subgroup of SU? Because if you take, of course, even dimensional affine space, you have holomorphic structure which is defined by this form. And of course, your group, subgroup of a linear transformation preserves this form if and only if E gamma is SU to N. Okay, so just in fact. But unfortunately, already starting from four-dimensional space, so you may not have the Crepant resolution. So it really exists for two-dimensional, three-dimensional space. Okay, so that's so. Okay, so this is kind of the really by now very well-known things. So, but now let's look at this group gamma as a kind of as a group theory looks like. So, of course, we again confine it in any, I guess, good textbook in algebra, and I think this will be by definition good textbook in algebra that contains this fact. That if you take the subgroup of SU2, of course, let's define gamma by center. And let's just for simplicity, not center, but by plus minus 1. It contains plus minus 1, the center. And I assume that gamma is not cyclic group of odd order, because then just you have to modify things. Otherwise, this group the always contains this center of this SU2, this diagonal matrices. And I just define this, and this, of course, now becomes a group in PSU2. And, of course, this is the group of automorphism of P1. And so now this is just polyhedral group. So this is a group of rotation symmetries of a sphere. And just so it can be given by generators and relations. So it's generated by, in fact, I is at most 3. And with this kind of genetic code, this kind of relations, and where these numbers satisfy this. And of course, because of the greater one, you can list them all, right? And this way you get all your Dynkin diagrams, just you'll get this solution, something like this. And there's also for cyclic group, I think, just. And so, and except cyclic group, this is always I is equal to 3 in this case. And this is your classification of all your subgroups of the SU2 or PSU2. Okay, but of course, what is this here? This, of course, this group acts on P1. And what is P1? Of course, there are three one-dimensional, simply connected one-dimensional manifolds. This is P1, C, and say I take this model unit disk. Or you can, if your favorite model is upper half plane, you can switch to upper half plane, it doesn't matter. So this is a three simply connected up to holomorphic isomorphic, simply connected one manifolds, complex manifolds. So we're kind of in this situation, P1. But if you consider but now you can consider the same kind of group as Epster group, but now switch inequality to negative one, then of course there will be infinitely many solution and R will be unbounded. Then this Epster group acts, so then your gamma is realized as a subgroup of SU, PSU, 1, 1, which is an automorphous group of the unit disk. This is by Merbius transformations. And how it acts here, so it has this kind of property, this is discrete, because now this is group maybe infinite, so this will be it's always infinite in this case, discrete and co-compact. And so, and additionally, because I use this thing, the quotient, what gamma, is isomorphic to P1. In this case. So this is usually called the Fuchsian group, co-compact. Fuchsian group. Of signature zero. Zero means for the genus or the quotient. The quotient also is compact Riemann surface, but it may have genus greater than zero. In this case, the genus is zero. And you put here numbers E1, ER. And this is notation for the signature. So this is, by definition, the Fuchsian, compact Fuchsian subgroup. It's just group that acts on the upper half plane on a unit disk, which is discrete, and quotient is co-compact, which is, in this case, of genus zero. And this is called the signature, this numbers. Of course, what are these numbers? These numbers are just there will be R exceptional orbits for the action. And this is just the orders of non-trivial isotropy groups. So the group may act trivially, freely on unit disk, and then the quotient will be Riemann surface of some positive genus. In fact, genus greater than one. But it may have some fixed points. And this is just the stabilizers of these fixed points. It will be R, representative R orbits. And this is cyclic groups, which is the orders of this cyclic. This is orders of a cyclic group. In fact, it acts very beautifully. Just if you think about unit disk as a hyperbolic space, you can think just as a D, as a two-dimensional hyperbolic space. Or, like coming from Russia, I would call it Lobachevsky space. So just so that then just this is what you do. Just you write polygon with angles pi over, say, E1. Say pi over E2, and take hyperbolic reflections into the sides of this polygon, and take subgroup of index 2, which preserves the orientation. So then just this group generated by reflection to the sides of this hyperbolic polygon, which preserves reflection, it's exactly this Fuchsian group of signature 0, and every Fuchsian group of signature 0 is obtained in this way. Okay, so of course, this you compare it to the case when group gamma is nice U2, again, take your favorite book on, I don't know, maybe it's not algebra this time. And of course, you see this kind of spherical geometry, right? And like a icosahedron gives you spherical subdivision by this kind of projection of a icosahedron, and it's generated again by this index 2 subgroup of rotations, in fact, in spherical geometry. This will be hyperbolic geometry. So somehow I'm switching from spherical geometry to hyperbolic geometry. And I skip this case because I don't know much about this case. I never thought about this case. There's generalization of what I'm saying in this case, but I completely skip this intermediate case, which is called the elliptic geometry, I think. So. Okay. So now this is so my first thing to generalize. So just now, I really go from finite groups to infinite groups. Now my group is a infinite group, not finite anymore. And now it, instead of acting on P1, so just my group. Also, I have the group gamma. So this is just gamma bar. So remember, of course, gamma in the finite case is a cyclic extension of this gamma. So this is, comes from the, because the fundamental group of SU2, because SU2 is simply connected, the fundamental group of this group is of order 2, and this is universal cover for PSU2. But in this case, you have, and this is finite case. In my case, I can also define gamma, but this time the center will be infinite group, and this is just only pre-image of gamma in universal cover of PSU1, 1. And this group now has infinite fundamental group, is Z, and so the preimage will be kind of infinite cyclic extension of gamma bar. And has, so now I have a group gamma, so this is my group. Replacing, say, subgroups of SU2. Of course, now I have infinitely many such groups. It's so much blackboard, but still not enough. I think you have to erase it very often, I think. Okay, so this is my group. So let's just, I want to, of course, generalize my chi correspondence. Let me look a little differently to this kind of things. Very simple remark. So suppose H is a normal subgroup of gamma. So in this, let's go look at this Bligin, King, and Reed theorem. And suppose my group gamma, choose a normal subgroup of gamma. So, and of course now, so let's divide not by the whole group gamma, but only for the, by the subgroup H. Okay, let's do the same kind of thing, but only divide by H. And then I have this category. Okay, and then look at this kind of equivalence of category. So now I have, I take my x and divide by h, and then on this, when I divide by h and resolve by using g-orbit, on my space, my quotient will group acts. Let g will be the quotient group. So that's now kind of funny situation, just like that's where this kind of thing applies. And now on this thing will act the quotient. Somehow the action, so on just a little, so this will, so it's my x on h. So if h trivial, this will just will be my group, just the whole gamma, right? Okay, and then must be equivalent. So my functor, that's my f, induce equivalence to this. So now if I take this kind of h, and so this will be the, this will be just there. And of course, this is the same thing as a kind of the usual thing, the original thing. This will be just, so just it really follows immediately this, from this kind of theory. So it's amorphous, this kind of corollary, just this. So this is just, if you kind of pass to finite subgroup, this just will be only to subgroup finite things. On this resolution, I will act the quotient group, and this will be this, by this theorem. But of course, this is just because, like, you do it, first x by h, and then x by g, you'll get this kind of thing, okay? So let me show this example. So let's take, again, kind of gamma is a subgroup of SU2. And take h in center. So let's take this plus minus one subgroup. So just this is just the center of this group, right? So now let's look at this thing. So now my g will be gamma bar, right? The image in the PSU2. Okay, this will be my gamma bar. Okay, now let's read it. So what do I get? So I get x. My x, of course, is C2. Okay, this is my x, right? Okay, what is this? Of course, x C2 mod plus minus 1 is a quadratic cone, right? It's A1 singularity, right? Okay? So what will be C2? Two slashes. It's minimal resolution, this thing, right? And of course, what is this? This is a cotangent bundle of P1. Right? When you resolve the quadratic cone, you get cotangent bundle of P1, and so your exceptional divisor is minus 2 curve, right, which you blow up from your exceptional curve, right? So what do I get? So this theorem tells me that the category of my gamma bundles on my cotangent ball, now, of course, on my cotangent bundle acts this group. The image in PSU2, it acts on the base, right, on my P1, right? And of course, it acts naturally on the cotangent bundle, right? Okay? And so now I read this thing, just this is my cotangent bundle, and the category of a gamma bar invariant shifts on cotangent bundle is exactly the same as what I want, is equivalent to the category of cogerent shift on my resolution of singularity. Okay? So this is my Mackay correspondence. So just so it's really gamma bar invariant, gamma bar linearized shifts on the cotangent bundle of P1, it's exactly my category of cogerent shift on my resolution, right? So this is Mackay correspondence. Okay, so now I'm erasing, think what will be the generalization. Okay, now look. Remember my gamma bar acts on P1, right? But now I suggest to replace P1 with a unit disk. Right? Because now this is kind of cries for generalization, right? What's written here, this is cotangent bundle of the one-dimensional, simply connected one-dimensional manifold. But now why not to take the disk? So now I really think what this one should be true. So okay. If I take the cogerent shifts, and of course this is an analytic situation, but in a minute I kind of reduce it purely algebraic situation. This is my defined group gamma bar. Now this is a Fuchsian group which acts on my unit disk. I take the cotangent bundle of the unit disk. Okay? And then I think this will be my Mackay correspondence. It should be derived category on the resolution. Of kind of T D mod gamma. So this is in fact a theorem. So this is my first theorem. Okay, so just I can consider again, let me just say. Now, this is a group X on D. I consider gamma invariant shifts on this cotangent bundle of the disk. And I say this is cohomology of the resolution. Let me just explain. So what's just kind of, if you're kind of scared, because this is, after all, algebraic geometry conference, not this kind of complex manifolds, right? So this is not compact, right? Okay. And so let me just pass it to, in fact, this is the way you prove it. So it's known, so this is kind of the proof. So let's reduce to a purely algebraic situation. So it's known that just gamma group gamma bar contains subgroups H, of which is a normal, which is torsion-free, and the of finite index. Okay. So in this case, if you take the D mod H, this will be compact Riemann surface. Algebraic curve for this conference, right? Of genus G greater than 1. And this group, of course, H will be just fundamental group. So this will be kind of universal cover. So the universal cover of C will be my D and H will be the fundamental group. So now I apply this kind of lemma again. Okay, now I choose my H, which will be subgroup of gamma bar. And I really see just what I have to show, just it's really just to show then just, of course, if I take and divide it by H, because H acts freely on my disk. So this will be nothing more just cotangent bundle of my algebraic curve C. Okay? And you see that the left-hand side is transformed to this derived category of cogerent shift. So let G will be the quotient group. And this is finite group, which acts on my curve C by automorphism, right? So this was normal subgroup. Now the quotient group acts on C by automorphism group. Okay? So the Riemann surface with automorphism group is equal to the H, the quotient group. So now I take this coherent shifts on my cotangent bundle of my curve C. This is now purely algebraic geometry. Okay? My group, it's Riemann surface, algebraic curve. This is a finite group of automorphism. It acts on the cotangent bundle, and I consider coherent shifts on this cotangent bundle, which are G linearized. And I want to show that this is just category of just coherent shift without any action on the resolution of this quotient. Okay? And now this becomes usual Mackay. So this fact follows from this Bringen King Perrine theorem, because cotangent bundle has a natural symplectic structure. This is how it came from physics, from mechanics, right? So for every manifold, cotangent bundle acquires a natural symplectic structure, in fact, holomorphic. If every action is holomorphic, yes, this curve is holomorphic. And of course, my G preserves this holomorphic structure. Every automorphism will preserve this holomorphic structure because it's natural symplectic structure on cotangent bundle. So my finite group acts symplectically on the surface. This is a surface in this case. And I read off this Mackay correspondence and get this isomorphism. And somehow for this, I really can get this by taking kind of pullback. Okay? So this is just, you can really, if you don't like this kind of this statement, so this is just a statement which really, but of course, what's the good about this statement? It doesn't depend on the choice of H. It's kind of uniform statement. There are many such subgroups, and somehow to state in this way, you have to choose H. Okay, with torsion, it's called surface subgroup of my Fuchsian group. And so just then, of course, but they all kind of glued together to one statement, which is this. Because this is completely uniform, it doesn't depend on the choice of this surface subgroup of your Fuchsian group. But just to prove it, you have to prove this, which is follows from Mackay. Okay, so this is just, let me just tell you now what will be the space, what's the resolution of singularities. Because now it's really easy to see this explicitly and see that something which is really familiar. Okay, let's look at what's the minimal resolution of the quotient of cotangent bundle by this finite group. And this is kind of looks something like this. Okay, so this is my curve C, and this is my cotangent bundle.
The isomorphism doesn't depend on the choice of H.
Hmm?
The equivalence.
Yeah.
Does not depend on H.
Yeah, yeah. But you have to show that it's kind of independent, right? It doesn't depend really on choice of H. Yeah. This kind of functor is kind of natural. Just as kind of, you take the common subgroup and just compare, I think.
Yeah.
Okay, now look at this, my action. So this is just, okay, something which, of course, was already here. Problem. So take this is my surface. Of course, not compact. This is cotangent bundle to my algebraic curve, to the smooth curve. And on the base acts my group, G, finite group. And then see, just it acts in this way, just on these fibers, it acts by multiplying by roots of unity. But will be kind of fixed points, and will be orbits of fixed points on the this is zero section of my surface. And then just this, when you divide and take the quotient by my G, so you get some kind of spoiled vector bundle. It still will be A1, but will be finitely many points, which is a cyclic singularity of type E1 minus 1. So this will be E2 minus 1, say ER minus 1. And this will be P1. Okay, because the quotient of C by, in this case, because my Fuchsian group of signature 0, of course, the quotient of C by G is a P1. So when you divide, the quotient of 0 section becomes P1. But this becomes the points with non-trivial stabilizer becomes cyclic singularity on the quotient of the type equal to the order of the isotropy group. So you get really R singular points of type E1 minus 1, E2 minus 1, E2 minus 1. Of course, what you have to do, you have to resolve them. And of course, we all know how to resolve a cyclic double rational point, right? So you resolve, and then you get this kind of curve, which kind of looks like Dynkin diagram. Okay, so this will be just like, I can really write it as an intersection. All these curves here are P1s, and all self-intersections are equal to minus 2, because my because my action preserves the symplectic form. So you can see this again. It's not quite trivial, but this curve is also minus 2. And this is a kind of Dynkin diagram, which I kind of draw only in the case when r is equal to 3 for simplicity. And some kind of the number here will be E1. The number here will say BE2. And the number of vertices here will be like ER, okay, but r is equal to 3. Okay? So for example, I take, for example, 2, 3, 7. This is kind of the first case after 2, 3, 5 gives you a icosahedron group. 2, 3, 7 is already give you Fuchsian group. And we have this kind of what's known in physics as a E10 diagram. And of course, you all know who study in recursive, so K3, this is a very familiar thing. This is a kind of equivalent quadratic form defined by self-intersection. This corresponds to the lattice E times hyperbolic plane. Right? So this is your Dynkin diagram. So now you get a fine surface, such as now what is the quotient, my cotangent bundle C mod G. It's kind of the open piece. It's kind of some not compact surface on which you have this kind of curve, which is like, again, now see we're getting something, because like for all this kind of icosahedron group and so on, you have the Dynkin diagrams of finite type. Now you go to realm of hyperbolic Dynkin diagrams. Now this is kind of hyperbolic Dynkin diagram. This is kind of type E10. In fact, this is kind of corresponds to Kac-Moody algebra. So this is root lattice of a hyperbolic Kac-Moody algebra. So this is what we see as a replacement of my Dynkin diagram in the classical Mackay correspondence. Okay. Now again, what is this kind of open piece? So you can compactify this thing. And what you do just, of course, what you do, you can really, in this, if you take the, you can compactify this cotangent bundle by adding section at infinity. And then, of course, you can lift the section on this cotangent bundle, this kind of minimal rule surface over C on the quotient. But now this is section at infinity. So this is cotangent bundle has 2g minus 2 self-intersection in this cotangent bundle. And section at infinity has 2 minus 2g, which is negative. You can blow this down, the section at infinity, and you get a cone over C. In fact, what you really get is you get the surface which is equal to the spec of canonical algebra of C. And of course, this is generated algebra, so this is just the canonical algebra of my curve C. And so this will be the quotient of this thing. So if you throw away this thing, this will be a fine thing. But the whole surface just will be the whole surface will be just proj of R C K C, and you have to take this what called cone projectant, projective cone. Okay, so this will be the whole comp, this will be, so this will be the so this will be T. Okay. So what's my surface? So there is a compactification of the surface. So this is just called this kind of VC or VG somehow. In fact, you can really see the surface just as a uniform way by not passing to this subgroup of finite index. This is just the same as a spec. You take the algebra of modular forms, holomorphic modular forms, again we had a talk about that, with respect to group gamma bar, and which is graded by the weight of these modular forms, and take the spec of this, and this will be like, now depends only on this my Fuchsian group, and this is a fine surface. So, for example, it has singularity corresponding to the zero, and when you blow up, you'll get kind of resolution of singularity. But this surface is an open piece, which is, there is a compactification of this thing. So there is a V, again, call this V gamma bar. And there is a compactification of this thing. And what's my surface is? So this is my open surface, and result the resolution. This is TG, plus this exceptional curve of resolution of V gamma bar. But if you resolve the surface, so this will be open piece which gives me this piece. So just like, again, so maybe I already confused, but let me just draw the picture. So let me just draw the picture in the case of R is equal to 3. So this is affine surface. So this is affine surface, so this is kind of the piece which has kind of singularity. So kind of when you resolve, you get kind of surface, and this will be exceptional divisor. Exception. But I take the projective cone, so just I kind of compactify, and this just resolution will be compactified, and but at infinity will be this kind of E PQR R or E E1 the curve, which I describe here. Okay. So there will be just my, if you get my surface, the quotient, then you have to throw away exceptional divisor, and this will be open piece. In the finite case, you're throwing away boundary, infinity, and this is just a resolution of singularity of double Russian point. So now passing from spherical geometry to hyperbolic geometry, you replace exceptional locus with the things what you see at the boundary. Okay? So for example, you take case like 237. Okay, what's your surface when you're this affine surface? It's singularity, this is affine surface. And we say gamma. You just this equation. And C3. You see? Remember, icosahedron group gives you x squared plus y cubed plus z to the 5 is equal to 0. When I go to 237, you get analog of icosahedron E8 singularity. You get this affine surface. The resolution of this thing is dull. It's not double rational point anymore. It's what's called minimal elliptic singularity. And so, in fact, in this case, the minimal resolution is just cuspidal curve. You don't see any Dynkin diagram at all, okay? You can make it kind of minimal resolution, but then it will be this kind of minimal normal crossing. It will be this kind of resolution, and this will be minus 1. If you do this normal crossing resolution. But what's interesting at the boundary, so what I do, I compactify. In fact, this is, has sister action. This is weighted homogeneous polynomial. Has sister action, and I can compactify minimally if preserving the sister action. And this was my surface. So my surface really, so what I get this kind of T mod gamma mod G is just really just an open piece, just this complement in compactification, and this minimum compactification on this my surface to the exceptional divisor. Of this V gamma bar. Okay? So I can have to throw away, this will be just surface, rational surface in this case, and I throw away this cuspidal curve and see what's left. And this is my surface. This is my replacement of the minimal resolution double rational point. Okay? So in my chi correspondence, this is what it is. So this is my space. So now it's not the minimal resolution of double rational point, but this open surface, which is a complement to resolution, I think. And instead of Dynkin diagram over the origin, I have the Dynkin diagram at infinity, which is of hyperbolic type. Okay. So now what I'm saying, so just so now, if I take any, so now just I have like 10 minutes. So this is just I already have this kind of thing. But of course, remember I started with Mackay correspondence, started with representations. So just to have true Mackay correspondence, I have to match somehow this thing with a some kind of theory of representation of my Fuchsian groups. Unfortunately, it's rather kind of terra incognita, I think, so even say experts don't know much about linear representation of a Fuchsian group. So now I take, in fact, I have to relate to the group gamma, which is central extension, instead of gamma bar, because it will be like binary icosahedron group. So now I want to generalize linear representation. Of course, before that, I deal with finite groups, and of course, every linear representation is equivalent to unitary representation, because it's a finite group. So it's very natural to consider not possible, not only linear representation, but only unitary. So I will be doing unitary representations. Also, I want to generalize a reducible representation. And again, this is some subtlety in the case. This is now infinite group. This is central extension of my Fuchsian group. So there's a notion what's called not a reducible representation. It's not a very good thing. It's called and it absolutely reducible. And so the reason for that is the following. Absolutely reproducible means if I restrict rho to any h of finite index, stays irreducible. Okay? So why I'm doing that? Because suppose it's not true, how I can get representation? Look, just take the subgroup of finite index normal and take irreducible representations. So they're all unitary, all this finite group, right? And of course, if I combine, compose, it's also a reducible representation. I can get some irreducible representation which factors for a finite, for some group of finite index. But now for these groups, even say for triangle groups, so group theorists prove that, except some kind of finitely many exceptions, you can always find in this Fuchsian group some group of finite indexes which maps to all symmetric groups. It's always possible to find subgroup of finite index for every symmetric group. For every, just think about it. For any symmetric group, in this kind of triangle group, I can find subgroup of finite index which is mapped to symmetric group. So I have to study unit representation of all symmetric groups, right? So you can't classify them, right? Because every subgroup is subgroup of symmetric groups. It's impossible to classify them. So if I don't do this kind of thing, my set is completely incomprehensible. I will never be able to describe the set, right? But there are much less of absolutely reducible representations. And this is kind of set is which I hopefully can describe, right? So now for my Mackay correspondence, I have to try to assign as a classical Mackay correspondence to every representation, I have to assign some vector bundle on my open surface. And which is kind of, if you look at this, my derived version of Mackay correspondence, this means it's compatible with that. If I take the complex which corresponds to, so what I can do, I think again, of course, if I have this kind of representation, I can again get again this kind of vector bundle corresponding to this irreducible representation on my resolution, which is compatible with this my derived version of Mackay. So there is a Mackay correspondence here. For, in fact, for every representation, not necessarily absolutely reducible, I can find this just, I can assign the same kind of bundle. And of course, what I want to see, and which I don't see yet, I want to take the, if this is absolutely reduced representation, I want to evaluate on one of these curves in the Dynkin diagram. So now I have this like E10 Dynkin diagram, and I want to see whether I can match some special admissible representation with the curves in this Dynkin diagram. So, but now we see that, in fact, this set is expected to be infinite, okay? Because it's infinite group, it's still there will be infinitely many absolutely reduced representation. This set is finite, right? I have an obvious problem, right? I can't match infinite set with finite set, right? Like in the finite case of the double Russian point. But it's not very surprising because look at the theory of representation of simple algebras or simple groups. You also have Dynkin diagram, right? But the number of reduced representations is infinite. What this kind of vertices of the Dynkin diagram corresponds to what's called fundamental irreducible representation. And every other representation comes from this Fermat construction. It's some quotient of tensor product. Okay? So this is a situation which should be the same as here. So I have to really find, for example, case 237, what's called 10 fundamental representation. This kind of absolutely reducible representation. And match them, match to the vertices of this Dynkin diagram of type E10, for example, in the case of 237. And then just every other, this is of course just kind of, it's a conjecture, but I have no any kind of foundation for this conjecture. It's just fantasy, really, because I don't know much, because I don't know much about this set, but this is what I hope. And my student is working on this. So I can really match, I can find for each vertex of this Dynkin diagram, in this case like hyperbolic type, I can find certain remarkable absolutely reducible representation of the corresponding Fuchsian group. And then every other irreducible representation comes from this kind of, as a quotient of tensor product. And remember, this all 10 unitary representations, so I can do this kind of this category just the simple, yeah, just the, okay. And, but of course I can do this even for 237. So for 237, so far, So like, for example, this 237 case, and of course this is the most remarkable case, the remarkable surface, I know two fundamental representations. And they are of dimension 2. And so this is because of dimension 2, there can never be, there must be fundamental representation. And they're kind of very remarkable representation. In this case, I can choose C, in this case 237, Klein curve, Klein quartic. And my group G, this simple group of order 168. And so what I'm looking for, I think, just to describe this admissible representation, I use the what's called Seshadri-Narasimhan theorem, that my representation of fundamental groups corresponds to stable vector bundle, which has a G-linearization. So there exist exactly two G-stable G-bundles on C, which really define, again, I have no time to describe, it's really generalization to the kind of stacked generalization of Seshadri theorem. So define two admissible representations, two absolutely reducible representations of this group gamma bar corresponding to 237. Okay. And so I'm kind of happy to say that this was discovered and reported on my first visit to Korea in 1997. There was a conference at Aegean. This was the first time I ever came to Korea. And this was the contents of my talk. I think just I kind of described this two bundles on the curve of genus 3. In fact, for any modular group, just if any kind of this is curve C replaced by XP, this modular curve of level P, the P is a prime number. And I described some of this for P is equal to 7, 11. So some kind of stable G bundles on this modular curve. So one bundle is very simple, just, and I think you can think about what there will be kind of natural bundle on the Klein curve. The Klein curve is genus 3. You embed it into Jacobian. And then take the normal bundle and twist it by some, there is some unique line bundle, which has some kind of root of canonical class, which is just generates the G invariant Picard of this Klein curve. And this will be one of these bundles. And there is another bundle. And of course, this is just also corresponds to what topologists do. Because if you take this 237, and you take the surface, which corresponds to V gamma, and take the link of the singularity at the origin, this is a homological sphere. So this is three-dimensional smooth manifold, whose homology looks like a three-dimensional sphere. And of course, my group gamma, in fact, in this case, is fundamental group of this link. This local fundamental group. In fact, this is true in every case, for every, so this is an interpretation of this group. My group gamma, this central extension, is nothing more just local fundamental group of this surface at the origin. The same as the case of double Russian points, of course, this binary polyhedral group is fundamental group of the local fundamental group of double rational point. In this case, it's local fundamental group of this my singularity, which corresponds to this group gamma bar. And what topologists do, they know that just the number of unitary representation of the fundamental group of a homological sphere, this is just invariant of smooth structure. And they invented this Carson invariant to compute the number of such unitary representation. But unfortunately, they did it only for the case rank is equal to 2. And they, for example, discovered for this link, which is a Milner sphere of 237, there are exactly two irreducible, which are in this case absolutely reducible representation of fundamental group. And they match with my two bundles. But already for rank 3, this is much less known, but there is a work of topologists in unitary representation rank 3. And they give me additionally two bundles on this Klein curve, but they are just symmetric products of the previous ones. So they shouldn't be considered as a fundamental. They obtain from these two bundles by this usual construction, taking like wedge product, a symmetric product, a tensor product. So I don't have to count them as a fundamental. They are really symmetric squares. So symmetric powers of my fundamental representation. So far it's known like 4, bundles, two of rank two, two representation of dimension two, two representation of dimension four, three, but three dimensional are symmetric squares of the two dimensional, so they are not really fundamental. So it's kind of remains to find eight more, and so I hope my students will find them. Okay, thank you very much.